limited. So I will go through the code and explain and run it so you can also run. As they were mentioning, please try to run the first file that is this introduction that you find in the folder. If you can access the folder with all the data, could you be so kind to use the emoticon, the up thumb, so I can see that you are somehow in the chat. Can you write an up thumb in the chat so I know that you are participating and you can access the main folder with all the material? Maybe somebody can also translate for me this.
Oh, oke, okay. Bapak Ibu, peserta webinar, mungkin nanti tadi panitia sudah men-share link drive yang dengan materi dari Prof. Mario. Nanti Bapak Ibu dapat meran tadi, kalau tidak salah, itu filenya adalah file R, ya, R sebagai software R. Di sini nanti boleh memberikan emoticon apa jempol jempol di kolom chat begitu.
Okay, thank you very much. So let me start. Let me see if I have control on my slides. Okay, so today, okay, can check. So today we will talk, as I was saying, we will talk about biomedical data science and some techniques that are available to analyze this, to analyze data that are machine learning techniques. They mainly come from statistics, as we will see. But we will try to understand why we call them machine learning and how useful they can be in real world problems. So why we do this? Because in those days, it's very important to have data and to have the ability to analyze data. As we have seen in the first part of this day, big data are everywhere. So data are produced everywhere. And from data analysis, we can know many different things. We can understand many, many different things. And so what we want to do is to try to learn as much as we can on machine learning, because this can really open a career path. Statistics say that people that work in data science earn nearly the double of other people working in similar fields, but not in data science. So for this reason, I think this is the first motivation, but also we want to become expert. And as we know, it is a very important those days to study. So I put a book in the folder because I want you to start reading, really reading materials. Because material is also a lot. No, if we look at, for example, if we go around and on the internet and we search material for machine learning, data science, there is a huge avalanche of data. For example, when we search on videos for machine learning, we end up with 14 million videos. Where should we start from? About 14 million videos are available on the internet. So where should we start from? This is sometimes it is unclear. That's why we take part to those seminars, workshops, so to find a way to dig this huge amount of information. And also, if we think about books, also books, there are so many. So if we search machine learning on Amazon and we want to buy a book, then we end up with 9,000 books. Where should we start from? It is very huge. So this is the reason why we should always start from very good starting point. And I think that these seminars are a very good point to start. So let me first of all define what is data science. So data science is something that puts together many different things. First of all, we need computer science. Why we need computer science? Because computer science will give us all the tools and the technological infrastructure that is needed to analyze data. So the databases, the operating systems, the programming languages, and all the software that we really need to gather the data and to analyze them. Then we need mathematics and statistics, because the modeling and the simulation and the data analysis comes from both mathematics and statistics. Nevertheless, what we need is the knowledge of the domain. So we will need to understand what we are talking about. So many data science is very useful, for example, to optimize the consumption of power, of electricity, but we need people that are, of course, expert of electrical of power grids. And if we apply data science to biomedical problems, of course, we have to stay together with people that are expert of this knowledge. So, in the end, as I was mentioning, computer science will give us all the high-performance computing infrastructures, the information systems, so the technological infrastructure, and also machine learning, because machine learning is somehow was born in this realm, and so forth. And when we think about math and the statistical tools, of course, we will have models, causal models, Bayesian models, and all the models like regression and the kind of ones that come from optimization, data reductions, and so forth. And nevertheless, we need the knowledge domain. So depending on which kind of biomedical data science we are addressing, so which problems we are addressing, then we will need a different expert. If we are in the realm of genomics, transcriptomics, proteomics, then we will need somebody that is aware of this. If we are in the realm of medicine, maybe of health systems, then we will need different professionals that will help us. So in a way, what the situation is today, is the actual situation is that we cannot solve all problems by ourselves, but we need to gather with other people that are experts from other fields. We have to put our competencies, our knowledge together to solve very important, very interesting problems. So no single person can address this, but we have to cooperate with others in projects to solve very interesting problems. And I think that Dr. Setia was telling this when he was introducing how a team of people is working on big data. So we saw that there are different professionals from the engineers to the data analytics people and so forth that cooperate to solve the problems. And this is exactly the same view, but this is exactly the same thing, but we see this from the data science point of view. So, as I was mentioning, in this folder, we have this book, Data Analysis for Life Science. And from this, I took only one chapter. So today we will talk about only one chapter. And you can download for free from the internet, or you can pay whatever you like. I really like this book because it's very simple. There is an accompanying website with some R codes from which I took some of the codes and I adapted for today's webinar. So if you want to give back to the author some money, you can go to the website and pay some money for the book that is already there. Otherwise, you can use it for free. So today we will talk the case study that we will take in consideration. It is very practical. Today it's an R session, the examples will be in R. We will take some data sets that are real. So this website is GEO, that is a database of gene expression data. What does it mean? It means that in this huge database, we will find millions of experiments that have been stored. And some of them are about gene expression. So there are tables in which there are, for many patients, the level of expression, the abundance of the genes. So we know that in our body there is DNA. DNA contains, for humans, contains about roughly 22,000 genes, and for each of them, each gene expresses, so produces a molecule that is called RNA, and the abundance of this RNA is very important because from those abundances, we can understand many things on our health. So if we are healthy or not. And as I was mentioning, so the problem is 189 samples. So these are the observation, the statistical units, and 22,215 are the variables, the variables of the problem, the gene abundance. So what I will use is I will use this dataset that is made of from several datasets to show the differences in the transcriptions in the transcription of several different tissues. Why is it important? Because if we can characterize an healthy tissue with respect to a diseased one, then we can make some diagnosis and we can also do some prognosis. So we can help medical doctors to understand what will happen if a person is really diseased, if it has what type of disease this person has, and also what will happen in the future. And maybe we can also use this information to understand which are the drugs that might be active for this type of disease. So we are helping the medical doctors to take decisions. We do from our point of view, that is the point of view of the data scientist. And of course, we need tools from computer science. No? If we use RStudio, RStudio was developed by a group of computer scientists. So we understand that without any of these pieces, we cannot solve our problem. So it's very important to cooperate with people that have different expertise, to gather in teams, and to try to address important problems. So, but what are the applications in biomedicine? Maybe we have a medical imaging, we have those machines like computer tomographies and fMRI, magnetic resonance, that give us images of what is inside our body. This is something very new. In the past, medical doctors did not have the ability to see inside our body to understand what was going wrong. But of course, the images that come out from those instruments need the data analysis technique to understand what is really happening. Then there are clinical expert systems. So there are systems that work for example, on scientific publication to understand what is written inside and automatically detect and understand specific facts about specific diseases. And also there are applications in the field of genomics. The one that we are seeing today is this metagenomics, for example, for the study of the microbiome and the effect on our health and so forth. And there are many of those applications. So this biomedical data science is very interesting and is also a wide place. There are many jobs available in this. So, but let's start with machine learning. And let's define what is machine learning. So I think that it is something very simple. Till a certain point, we have been writing a computer program to solve a problem, right? So if we wanted to compute the standard deviation of a sample, we were writing a small program to compute the standard deviation. Today, we write a program in such a way that this program can learn from data and can solve the problem. So we write a program so we can train a computer to solve the problem. So there is an intermediate step in which it's not the program in itself anymore solving the problem, but the program helps the computer to understand in a way what is happening and to solve the problem. So of course this is a part of artificial intelligence, because there is no intelligence without training. There is no intelligence if we don't learn, right? We know that our intelligence also in humans is based on learning. So machine learning is usually divided. Those methods, so those programs that we use to train computers to solve problems, are usually divided in two big broad classes that are supervised or unsupervised. What does it mean? Let's see. So when we talk about, let me firstly start with what type of problem can we solve. As I was saying, we can train a computer to answer questions. So any problem that can be posed as a question can be solved with machine learning. So a simple question can be the one from a doctor that says, is this patient healthy or diseased? So there are only two possible answers. The patient is healthy, no disease, or the patient has a disease. So when I can put this problem in the form of a question, then I can use machine learning to solve this. And we will see in more detail how to do this in practice, how we do this. Then we can find patterns in data. So what we can do is to try, when we see many observations, many statistical units, we can try to gather them together if they are similar, and we can try to keep them apart from others. So we can construct communities, we can build up communities, clusters, in which we group things that are similar, and we take them apart from things that are different. Then we can understand which are the variables that are important to in a problem. For example, if I want to discriminate between female and male, I can say, is a person that is 2 meters tall, that is 8 kilograms heavy, that has very short hair, female or male? And maybe those variables, so how tall a person is, how weight, what is the weight, and the length of the hair will help us. There will be some other variables like the color of the eyes, or if they have a nevus here or not, that will not discriminate between if they have big hairs or small hairs. So those variables will not help in discriminating if somebody is man or woman, and if this is a man or a woman. And this is so. Machine learning helps us to understand which are the real important variables that we need to do. And then we can also try to understand what are the errors. So, because in biomedicine, in biomedical application, there is a natural variability. If we talk about humans, we are all the same, but everybody is a little bit different from each other, right? They are slightly different. We say that we are 5% different from each other. And we have to understand if we see something that is very, very different, if this is an error, if this is just within the human variability, or this is something that we should really take care of because, for example, it is telling us that there is a disease. Then we can behave, we can try to detect behavior, we can try to understand what are the causality relations and so forth. So, but let's make some example. Today we will analyze 2-3 techniques, and then we go to the R Studio, and I will show you how this is implemented in R. So we will talk broadly about supervised and unsupervised learning. And within supervised learning, we will talk about classification. Within unsupervised learning, we will talk about clustering. These are methodologies that have been also been developed in statistics, but then in computer science. And we will see what are the differences, and we will try to understand a little bit better about this. So let's talk about clustering. Clustering methods are used to find similarities. So we have a set of observations, we have 100 people, we want to divide these 100 people in small groups so that in each group people are very similar to each other and are very different from people in the other groups. This, of course, what is similar and what is different depends on the distance that we use, in what we mean similar and what we mean different. I always tell this story about my kids. I have 2 children. They are more or less in the same age. Now they are grown up. But when they were small, they liked to draw. They liked to draw. And so one day they came to me and they asked for a crayon, for a pencil, a colored pencil, to draw, to finish their drawings. And they were asking me for a pencil, for a blue pencil, to draw the sky. So I went to their room and I looked for 2 pencils that were exactly the same blue, because I didn't want them to fight. You know, children always fight. Oh, mine is better than you. I want that. I want that. So I took those 2 pencils that were exactly the same blue and I gave 1 each. And they started fighting. Why? Because 1 pencil was small and the other pencil was big. So for me, it was important that the 2 pencils were the same blue. For them, it was important that the 2 pencils were the same size. So Of course, what is important, what makes two things similar or dissimilar depends on the measure, on what we measure. So we have always to be very careful to have an expert of the field that tells us, look, this variable is relevant to this problem, or this variable is completely useless for this problem, because the statistical significance and the biomedical relevance are very different concepts. So let's make an example. So these are superheroes. Do you like cartoons? I hope that you like. Maybe you know Spider-Man, right? And maybe you know Captain America, Iron Man, Mickey Mouse. There are many of them. So let's say that we want to cluster them. So we want to put together the superheroes that are more similar to each other. So I could decide, for example, that I put together all the superheroes that have blue clothes. So Captain America has blue dress, so maybe he can go with the Spider-Man, blue and red, but it doesn't go with Iron Man because Iron Man is red, right? And also, what happens is that we can group, or we can divide female superheroes from male superheroes. And so we have a different grouping. So depending on what is important for us, we will have what is the important variable, the color of the dress, or the sex, or whatever, the length of the hair, or whatever we can divide. Or, for example, what type of superpower they have. They can fly, they can fight, or whatever. But here we see that there is an outlier. So there is something that is completely different from all the others. I don't know if you have the ability to write on the chat, but maybe if you can write on the chat, maybe you can write me which is, for in your opinion, the error, the outlier among those. I don't know if you can really write in the, no, you cannot. Okay, so in my opinion, an outlier is Mickey Mouse, because Mickey Mouse has no superpowers. He cannot fly, or he cannot be very strong and destroy a building just with smash a building, right? Or he cannot fire anything. So Mickey Mouse is an outlier. Or, for example, here in the bottom left part of my slide, there is something that is not very clear, right? We don't really see who is this superhero. And so this is an error. So somehow the image was corrupted and we cannot see. So in real problems, we have this type of problems. We have errors and that come from different sources. So let's start with our example. We said 189 observations, the TAR tissues for 22,000 of genes. And we want to put them together. We have two possibilities. One is to gather them hierarchically, and the other is to partition them. What we mean by hierarchically? So what we can do is to take all of them and to try to divide, to find which are the groups that are more different among each other. Once that we have done this, we take the one group and we split again, trying to understand what are the ones that are more different from each other. So what we do, we compute a tree, we compute a dendrogram. We can do this top and down, as I was mentioning, or bottom up. So we put together, we take all the observation and we gather together the ones that are more similar. If we start from the bottom, we call agglomerative. If we start from the top, divisive clustering. To do this, again, we need to compute some distances, and this is very important. So in case we want the clusters to aggregate the clusters together, we need to measure the distance between these groups of observation. And we can do this in several ways. So this is an example. So in case, for example, of agglomerative, let's say that we have those observations, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So we start computing the distances between them, among them, and we see, for example, that 1 and 5 are the closest one. So they are within a certain distance among each other. So what we do is we take one and we take, sorry, we take one and five and we put together. Then we see that one and five, then we go to the next step and we see that three and four are closer together within at a certain distance. So we take them and we put them together. Then we go to the next step and we say, what are the elements that are closer to each other? Now two is very close to one and five. So we put it together. Two, one and five is one cluster, three and four is one cluster. So we can cut at different levels, at different distances. So we can say, what are the elements that are closer to each other at less than this distance? And we get a group. Okay. And we can do this with average, single, or distance between those groups. So there are various, we will use complete in our example. So now I will start sharing my R Studio and we go to a practical part, okay? So let me see if I can share my R Studio. If I see it, here it is. So, I hope that you can see my R Studio, right? So as I was saying, so this is our R Studio, and here on the right, we have the files. So I have, today we will use only three files. One is the introduction, and this is the one that I was asking you to run. This is to install the packages that we require. Some are required for the plotting, this and ggplot2, and some other are required for the clustering. This is required for the confusion matrices and so forth. This is for classification and it's two times here. So when we run it, this will install all what we need. Here we go to the run section. You see, we go to the run section and we can say either run it all together from here, or I can say run this section. Here, for example, I can say run this section and my R Studio will run this section. This is the console part of the interface. And then I install the packages that we require today. Okay, so it runs and this is the result. KnitR is very useful and is used here to produce some PDF starting from this. The book itself that I was giving you in the folder has been written in R. So let's go to the clustering example. So these are the instructions for the Knit for this program. So I want a PDF and or a HTML, and the title will be clustering. Here there are some instructions for Knit. Let me run. So at the end I will show you how to produce the PDF. And now we load the libraries. As we know in R, we need to load the libraries so that we can add the functionalities to the software. And in particular, I will load this library that also contains the data that we will use today. So this library is the one that obtains. Here, if we press on this, we run this section. This means that it will run all the instructions that go from this symbol to this symbol. So this is an easy way. We could also just select them and run from here, or run all selected lines, or we can go, if you have a new version, a new enough version of R, we can run on this small R of here, and it will run it. So what we are doing is we are loading the libraries. You see, little by little, it shows us that we are doing. And I will comment about the single libraries that we are using little by little when we use them. So here I use this because in this one there are the data. This is a library that is provided with the book with some extra functionalities, those two. This is the library that contains the clustering algorithm. This is the library that will help us in filtering out the variables. And these are the plot libraries. So now we load the data. As I was mentioning, the data is contained is the gene, the tissue gene expression data. And it is composed on the 189 samples for seven different tissue types. So the, as I said, the statistical units, the observations are the tissues. We want to understand which tissues are similar to each other and which are different when we use as variables the gene expression. So the level of abundance of RNA in the set. So what we do here, we load the data, we ask for the dimension. So the variable that contains the data is here. It's called E. And as we can see, this is a very large matrix because it contains, as I said, 189 rows and 22,000 columns. Now, if I ask to have the head, we will see the first four elements, the first four rows of the first four rows, we will show the first four elements. And this is the result of this command, right? So what we see is that we have a specific tissues. So in this case, the matrix has been loaded, transposed. So on the columns, we have the observations, and on the rows, we have the variables. So, and here, the variables. And here, we have also a description of what type of how it is stratified, the variables. So we have 38 tissues that are cerebellum, 34 that are colon, and 15 that are from the endometrius, and 31 and so forth. We see that placenta is the less represented tissue. It only has six observations. Okay, so now, as I was showing in my slides, to put together our elements, we have to understand which are the ones that are closer to each other, right? So I have to compute a matrix that is a matrix that contains all the pairwise distances among the elements. And what I do is exactly this. I take the transpose of the matrix E, that is the matrix of the data, and I compute the Euclidean distance among all the observations. So we have a vector with 22,000 variables, and we have another vector, and we compute the distance. Those vectors represent the tissues, the variables are the gene expression levels. So we want to compute all the pairwise distance. Of course, this will take a while. So let me run it while I do this, because computing the pairwise distance between 189 variables, it will be 189 times 188 divided by 2 computations. Each of these will be performed on 22,000 variables, so this will take some time. Okay, so now we see that a new variable appears, that is this D, that it has a certain number, these elements. So in the D distance, we have all the distances between the parts. Now we can do hierarchical clustering. So we can start asking, okay, what are the elements that are closed to each other? So if I allow a certain distance, how many of these pairs together? And then how many of these continue to group together? So, and this is exactly what we will do in this section of the code. So hierarchical clustering. This is to produce a nice figure using CNITAR. So we don't, and this is to set some nice parameters. But what the real thing that we need is the function that computes the hierarchical clustering. So we will compute the hierarchical clustering on the matrix of distances using the method complete. You remember we said that there are different ways to aggregate the groups together. So we decided to use the complete. So we will compute all the distance between the elements, and we will use this overall distance to aggregate the small parts together. And then we will make a plot. Here there is the AC, so we will show when we run this will give us the labels, so to which cluster the elements belong, and we can plot the dendrogram using the plot. Plot is a general function, so it detects what are the variables that we are giving, and it decides what is the best plot to produce. So since this object is C, that is the output of the H cluster function, is the result of a clustering, plot knows that it has to use a dendrogram to show the results. So let me run it, or let me run all. Okay, let me run all of them, and what it produces is this picture. Okay, let me make it a little bit bigger for you. So what is happening here? We have 189 samples that are all these ones that have been colored with respect to the tissue. You see in this column, we have used as labels the tissues, and the lab, you see the lab color is tissue. And we have used, this is for the size of the font that we want to use. I used 50% of the default one. So what we see is that all the many of those cluster together. So these are all coming from the same. For example, here is written hippocampus, the orange one. And you see they come together, but some of different colors come together. This means that some of those observations, for example, those two green ones, those violet ones, look more close to the orange one than to the other violet one. Okay, you see here the pink one, they cluster together and so forth. What is this indicating? As we said, here we are computing the distance. So these two elements, those two factors, those two samples are close at this level. So these two are, for example, closer than these other two. You see, they join here at an higher level. So whatever I cut, if I put a line at some point, I will detect a certain number of clusters. The number, if I cut here, I define two clusters because I only see two intersections with this horizontal line. If I cut it here, I will have more. So let's try to cut at for example, 120. Okay, and let's see what happens. So what we do, we add this line. Again, we do the clustering and we cut at 120. Let's see what is the effect of this. There will be an horizontal line at 120. And the number of times that this horizontal line hits the vertical line will be the number of clusters that we have identified. So if depending at what level we put our line, then we will have more or less clusters. For example, when we cut here, all the green elements, except those two, they group together, you see? So we have a cluster that is pure, it only contains the green. While here we have two more clusters, one cluster that is composed only of those two green, and another cluster that is composed because it's cut here, so all those elements go together, and so that is composed by two violet, two cyan, and two green, dark green elements, and so forth. We can do this, or we can do in another way. We can say, okay, cut in such a way that I obtain the fixed number of clusters. So what I can do is I can ask to cut the tree at that is the tree that is related by the clustering that I was doing before at level 8. Okay, so what I do, I obtain 8 clusters. Okay, so it will put, it will group, it will find a line that is intersected automatically only in 8 points. And so we produce 8 clusters. So each clusters will contain the cluster labels. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 till 8, and we will have the we can compare the clusters that it has obtained with the real labels. So we know that we had that our samples were divided in 7 tissues. You remember, placenta was the less represented with 6 elements. And then now we have those clusters. Now we have to understand the how the automatic technique is grouped together. So this is a contingency table, and the table is exactly the command that produces the contingency table. So the true elements are the tissue, whereas the predicted one, the columns, are the clusters that have been detected by the clustering algorithm. As we can see, if we look, there are some, for example, cluster 8 only contains elements from the placenta. So this is a pure cluster. In this cluster, there are only the elements that are from placenta, and in this specific case, these are all and only those elements. For example, cluster 7 has all the five elements that belong to cerebellum. The others are in other clusters. So 5 went in cluster 7, but 31 went in cluster 3, and 2 went in cluster 6. So if we look on the columns, we can detect which are the pure clusters. So the ones that contains only elements from one type. And if we look on the rows, we see if the all elements have been put in the same cluster or not. Of course, sometimes we have this information, but in general, we don't know from the beginning what are the type or how are the samples organized. So if we know, we can use this, otherwise we cannot. So let me talk about another clustering algorithm. This is a clustering algorithm that is called hierarchical clustering. So till now, we have explained what is a clustering, what does clustering mean? So group together objects that are similar to keep them apart from objects that are different. Now that we saw that there are two main methodologies. One is hierarchical and another is partitive. So I will share again my slides. If I see them, that's it. And we go on discussing about the partitive algorithm. Partitive algorithm, there are many. We'll talk about k-means, but there are many, many algorithms that have been devised to cluster data. But how does k-mean work? So k-mean works in a very simple way. So k-means is puts together using a very simple strategies. So now we will make an example and we will go through it. So look at this picture on the right. This point, these big points, the big dots are the center of mass, are the averages, the mean of the cluster. This means that if we take, these are points in a bidimensional space, so these are Euclidean points in a bidimensional space. If we compute for the first coordinate, the x-axis, the mean, and for the y-axis, the mean, what we get is this point that has those coordinates. We can do this for all the clusters. In this picture, we have a situation in which we have three clusters, the blue, the green, and the red. So how does k-mean do this? Let me directly describe this with an example. So we draw some random points in our dataset. So the gray points are the points in our dataset, and we just draw some random points within this. Now what we do, we try to say, we take every point and we say, is it closer to the blue, this point here? For example, let me see if I have a pointer. I don't have a pointer. If I take this point here, is it closer to the blue, to the red, or to the green? Of course, this is closer to the blue. And I repeat this for every point that I have here. The result of this is a colored map. It's a colored map okay it's a colored map. As you can see, all the points have been assigned to these random points that were closer. Now I take those points. So for example, this point, if I take the top point, the top red point, this will, let me, okay. If I take this point here, sorry. So if I take this point, okay, so if I take any point here, they will be assigned to the closest center. Now, I take all the red points and I recompute the average. I take all the blue points and I recompute the average. So the center of mass. I take all the greens and I recompute it. So I get some new points. You see, there is a light blue, a light red, a light green point. And I start reassigning the points. So now I ask for every point in the plane, is it where, what is the center that is closer? And I repeat this iteratively. So step after step, I gather the points with respect, I put them in the cluster of the closest centroid, then I recompute those averages and I repeat this. This procedure is not, it can converge in a certain number of points, or I can stop after a certain number, let's say 40 times. I repeat this assignment 40 times unless until I find the situation. Since I started from random points, every time I repeat, I might get a different answer. So every time I use this type of clustering, I might get a different clustering. So points might be in different clusters. Do you want to see this in R? I will show you. But before this, we have to say that there are many things that we have to decide when we use this type of clustering, and also all the other many other types of clustering. First of all, how many clusters should I use? And then, what are the attributes? So what are the variables that should be used? And what is the unit of measure? Do we need to rescale the units? Because if I have something that is very big, so like one variable that has a unit that makes the numbers very big, when we compute the distances among the points and the center of masses, this will have an influence. Big numbers will count more than small numbers. But let me go to the R studio so I can show you also another. Where is the R studio? I have too many. Here it is. So let me share it to you. So now we want to use k-means, okay? So as you can see, we start with the k-means. K-means is here. So now we will use k-means clustering to cluster the data. The representation that we will use, it will be on a plane. So what we do here, we take this data set that has 22,000 variables, 22,000 dimensions. We project it first on a plane using an algorithm that is called multidimensional scaling. And then we will use only those two variables to do the clustering. So that's why there are so many. Okay. So the representation, sorry, the clustering will be done, sorry, in the original dimensions, but the representation will be done in a b-dimensional space. So let's see what happens here. We can, the command to do the clustering is very simple. So what we do, we take k-means, we use k-means, that is this function that is in the, that is in the cluster library, and we apply it to the matrix of the data, the original matrix, not the distance matrix, as we were doing in the hierarchical clustering. We have to transpose it because k-means requires that the observations are on the rows and the variables are on the columns. And we decide that we want 7. And we can take seven clusters. So, Let me finish this and then there will be time for questions, okay?
Bagaimana Ibu Bapak ada pertanyaan atau tidak?
Sepertinya Prof. Mario gangguan, Bu.
Oh. Oh, katanya listriknya ini.
Oh, mohon maaf Bapak Ibu, ini ada gangguan teknis.
Listriknya mati katanya.
Mungkin Bapak Ibu ada yang ingin ditanyakan sejauh ini, sejauh apa tadi pemaparan materi oleh Prof. Mario, boleh nanti dituliskan di kolom komen, di kolom chat. Nanti ketika Prof. Mario sudah bergabung, bisa kami tanyakan, ataupun nanti bisa kami emailkan ke beliau. Dan Bapak Ibu mohon menuliskan pertanyaannya beserta nama dan afiliasi dari Bapak Ibu. Begitu. Mohon maaf, ini di luar kendali kami, ada kesalahan teknis karena Prof. Marionya ternyata di rumahnya mati listrik ini. Mungkin saya ini ya ke pembawa acara ya, Mbak Dia. Kok itu hilang?
Sebentar Bu, Mbak Dianya baru
gimana Bu Emma ini?
Mungkin
oh,
beri dulu 10 menit nggih. Kalau ada pertanyaan
oke,
mungkin
Bapak Ibu.
Apa, monggo. Apa terkait planningnya, apanya gitu monggo.
Oke, Bapak Ibu, kita sedang menunggu Prof. Mario, mungkin kita akan istirahat dulu sebentar selama 10 menit. Jika Bapak Ibu tadi mempunyai pertanyaan atau ada kesulitan ketika tadi file R-nya sudah di-run gitu, ada kesulitan boleh ditanyakan di kolom chat, atau mungkin nanti jika ada pertanyaan boleh pakai bahasa Indonesia, nggak apa-apa, nanti kami coba bantu untuk translate-kan ke Inggris gitu. Nggih, matur nuwun.
Ini bagi yang error, mungkin kami diberitahu ya, errornya di mana ya?
Bu, Bu Ari. Ini Prof. Mario sudah bergabung lagi, Bu Emma. Tadi ini saya mau, sudah
coba di, saya. Di welcoming aja sama Bu Dina.
Welcome back, Prof. Mario. Tadi sebenarnya, sudah. Prof. Mario. Kok keluar lagi ya? Mana ya? Oh, ini.
Okay, there was a power outage. So when in the time it takes me to restart all my Windows, the R Studio and everything. Do you have any questions for what we said so far that I can answer?
Okay. Bapak Ibu monggo jika ada pertanyaan. Prof. Mario, maybe I have a question for you.
Okay.
As a statistician or maybe data scientist, we have already learned several methods in machine learning like clustering, classification. But if I interest in bioinformatics or biomedical, honestly, I don't really know about the data, Prof. Mario. The kind of the data and then how to understand the data. So, as I know from Miss Emma, the data is from image, right? And then the do some conversion, so the data can interpret in the table or in the numeric. How to understand about the biomedical or bioinformatics, especially for the data? Thank you, Prof.
So, this is a very important question, because data from different applications can be very different. And for this reason, we have to be very, very careful. Not only the data in itself has also some characteristics. As I was mentioning, for example, when we use a gene expression data, we have a table of real numbers, right? Because for every patient, for every tissue in our example, we were measuring the abundance of a gene, and this abundance is a number. So we have some quantitative variables that are continuous, and we have to use those variables. But there is also something that is related to this data, because when we do the experiments, what happens is that we have some errors. So we measure something, and when we measure something, we usually have some errors. And we have to take care of this, also missing value and so forth. But where do we take the data? So where do we can download the data? So there are many different repositories that are freely available. If you want, if this is the question, where to get the data, you want me to answer also this question?
Sebentar, Pak Amar, kalau mau bertanya langsung boleh, Pak Amar?
Will you translate for me the question?
Oh, not. Not. Sebentar. Oh, there is a question from Mr. Amar Yasid from Universitas Brawijaya. What the difference when we do the computational between R and Python in data science? Which one is?
I couldn't hear. Can you repeat? I couldn't hear.
What is the difference when we do the computational data with R and Python? Maybe which one is the easier?
So this is we know in data science there are two major languages that are used. There are many. There are many languages. But those days people like either Python or R. And one to choose, I would say choose both. So if you can learn both languages, learn R and learn Python, because they have different characteristics. So for example, R is very strong from the statistical point of view. It has been developed by statisticians, and it has been developed for statistics. So what is important, so it's very important for statistics, the plots are very beautiful and so forth. And but it has some limitation with respect to the data structures that we can use. So Python is more flexible from this point of view. It has, so it comes from a C language, so it has a different structure and a different capacity to handle the data. So if you have a very complex problem that requires very complex algorithms and data structures, for sure Python is better. If you have something that is more statistically heavy, so you need very strong methodologies, then the ones that are implemented in R libraries are for sure more interesting, are better from this point of view. So depending on the application, I would use either one or the other. I have the same course developed also in Python, because in some communities, people ask for Python codes. In other communities, they ask for R codes. So depending on what people think, and also on the background. So usually R is more from statistics departments, rather Python is more for computer science, engineering, and so forth. I see another questions. My name is Andri. Hello, Andri. Industrial engineering. I would like to ask you a question. How do you determine key features in our data, since big data may contain many attributes or variables? So we can take our prediction more accurate. So this is very challenging and very important question. As I said, choosing the variables depends on the problems that you have. So the statistics, machine learning, data analysis, data analytics don't know anything about your problem, right? Those disciplines provide models, but models don't know anything about your application. We can apply k-means to many different problems, right? Depending on the problem, some variables will be more important, some others will be not. So first of all, you have to have somebody that is that knows the problem, so an expert of the problem. And this person will tell you from his knowledge what are the most important variables. He knows that some variables are useless, whereas some others are more important. Then there are some techniques that you can use. First of all, it depends if there are missing values. So the percentage of missing values that you have in your data. If some variables have very few observations for which there is the value, then maybe it's better to throw. So first of all, in the exploratory part, we should look at what are the variables content. Then there are some other techniques that are based, for example, on the variance and the standard deviation. So if I have a variables that for all the observation has very little standard deviation, so the numbers are all the same, I'm talking about quantitative data, why should I introduce it in my model? If the values are all the same, why should I introduce it in my model? Or if there is very small values, so all the observation have very small variables. So maybe this variable will not add anything to it. So it will be, so if the signal is very weak, I can avoid to use it. Then what I can do, I can look at the correlation structure. So I can look at how the variables correlate to each other. If the variables are very much correlated, and this is very simple to do, I can compute a variance covariance matrix and I can just plot a heat map of it. I will see that if there are very high values of correlation, this means that these variables are all telling the same story. So I can decide using an expert, asking for the help of an expert, just from one variable between every group of very high correlated variables. This structure comes out very, very often, especially in biomedical application and especially in genomic application, because there are several genes that have the same function. So we will see that they have the same behavior, or groups of genes that have the same behavior. So taking them all, or taking just one or two, it doesn't make much difference. And then there are other techniques. If we talk about classification, so if we have an information about the samples, then we can use some other techniques like recursive feature elimination or other feature selection technique that might be of help. But thank you for this very interesting question.
Thank you, Prof. Mario. There is another question for our students. Rahma from statistics. Is it necessary to update genetic data regularly, or is it enough to search the experiment from past data?
Sorry, can you say it again? I can't hear your voice.
Is it necessary to update genetic data regularly, or is it enough to search the experiment from past data?
So experimental data and the other type of data isn't? I couldn't hear. You were doing a difference between experimental and?
To update genetic data or gene expression data.
So when we talk about this type of data, this data has also metadata. So when we talk about data is also described by some other data. This description is continuously updated. So when we talk about a gene, no, what is a gene? For example, in breast cancer, one gene that is very important is TP53. But what is TP53? The definition of what is TP53 changes over time. So they adjust because they study, they understand that the sequence is a little bit longer, that one intron is a little bit shorter. So this information that is contained, for example, in the human reference genome is updated. So it is very important to regularly update both data and metadata about our problem. These data are available from a big database. I was talking about Geo data bank that is a large data set, Geo. It's called GEO, and it's the links that I provided in my slide point to that database that contains millions of experiments. So we can start from a problem that we like. Maybe we find some data that is already pre-processed. So we find it in an Excel table in which we have observation and variables, and we can start applying our algorithms on that. But keep in mind that this data is continuously updated. So we should continuously search for it. There is another question from, I hope that another this answered the question. So another question is from Anga. So k-means. So as I was saying, what are the benefits of k-means in data science? And
maybe the question.
I will answer also to this other question. So. So the question from Anga is unsupervised techniques like clustering are very important because the labeled data, so data for which we have an additional information like what type of tissue it is and so forth, is much less than unlabeled data. So in the world, when we look for example at images are very often unlabeled. So if we want, for example, we have a database of images coming from internet, and we want to know if what are the images that contain animals, we might decide to use clustering to put together all those images that look similar to each other and might contain, and among those clusters, we will look for clusters that contain animals. So the clustering is the first step in a situation in which I have no information about my data. So what I use clustering to put together the observation that looks similar. So I try to find patterns, to find the common patterns in my data in order, in my samples, in order to gather them together. So there is a question on install remotes. I think that the error that returns R Studio is not correct. Let me share
the participant face the error when run
So
let file.
Because when you install R says install remotes, but this does not exist, so you should use another function. Let me see, that is install dot just a moment, because let me see if I install packages dot remotes. This will install remotes. Okay, so you have to run install packages remote, because install in itself does not work. Okay, I hope this answer the questions for some of the errors that we have. Let me stop sharing. Okay, so there was another question actually. Let me see.
From Hafiza. Sepertinya ke out lagi nih Bu Emma.
Iya, ke out lagi Bu.
Oh, mohon maaf Bapak Ibu, Prof Mario-nya ke out lagi.
Saya tambahkan, Ibu Bapak yang run-nya error, pertama itu harus library Biok Manager ini ya. Kemudian setelah itu install remotes, kemudian setelah itu install genomic class yang ini. Insya Allah setelah itu nanti tinggal yes, no, run gitu ya. Ini Pak Marianya ada lagi.
Mungkin memang butuh waktu yang agak cukup lama ya Bu, tergantung kecepatan internetnya ya, karena kita installnya kan secara online gitu ya Bu.
Pak Marianya monggo silakan. Udah fokus lagi.
So that's it. Sorry. So there were some questions. Can I don't know if I see the chats anymore.
Okay.
No, my chat is clean. Can you rewrite the last question, please?
Di copy paste aja mungkin. Okay.
From Havizaprov.
Ah, thank you. Thank you very much. So I was seeing that my backdrop is the other way around. So let me see in the preferences. So Nick says, my name is Hafiza.
Hafiza.
Thank you. Hello, Hafiza. As we know, K means working by put the centroid points randomly so that it can produce different classes. How we can validate that the cluster results are good or not? Is there a specific theory to determine what number of group is best? Okay. So if you look, so thank you. This is very interesting questions. And actually, in the let me share the. Let me share. Okay, let me share again my R, because there is this part at the end of the file that I was providing. There is this part that says how to choose the right number of clusters. Okay, so that is in this part here, is the very last part. So there are several ways to do this. The easiest thing to do is to use what is called the ELBOV method. So what I do is I run the algorithm several times and I compute the within sum of squares. So this is a quantity that is automatically, this is the code to do this from line 99 to 104 is the last part. And what we do is a quantity. This quantity says somehow how distant are the points that are within a cluster. Okay, so the higher the worst, the lower the best. Of course, when I add more and more clusters, the number of elements within each clusters will be less. So also the sum of squares will be smaller. So if I say I have 189 samples, I want 189 clusters, of course, in each cluster, maybe there will be very few, one, zero, or very few elements, and this will make this sum very small. What is important is not the absolute value of this sum of squares, but rather the way in which it changes. So when there is a very high change, you see the gradient here from 1 to 2, it drops down very highly. Then from 2 to 3, the line as the gradient is less, no? So here 2 is already a good choice. After 4, we see that there is no improvement. So we see this is from 3 to 4 and 4 to 5. Did this have the same direction? You see, so stopping to 4 in this case is a good choice. Among the I gave you one of the there is one of the libraries that contains 100 more than 100 of more than an, I don't remember the name. Let me go back to the top of our. I think it was, there is one of the libraries that contains more than 100 of those methods. So there is no standard way, there is no single way to decide which is the best number of clusters, but there are several ways. The ELBOV method is the one that is more often used because it's very simple. I try with several number of clusters, I observe how the within sum of squares changes. When the gradient of the change becomes small, zero, near to zero, like in the case between 3 and 4 and 4 and 5, I stop. And I decided that 4 is a good number of clusters. There was another question, right?
From Mr. Guzzi from Jakarta.
Okay, let me see if I can... Just a moment, because I don't see the main. Okay, this is it.
Sepertinya keluar lagi, nggih. Iya, Mbak Dia.
Iya, Bu, keluar lagi.
Ngapunten Bapak Ibu, ini ada kendala teknis.
Oh, itu ada yang dia masuk.
Tolong di-admit ya.
Ampun, Bu.
Bangke. Ya, saya tuliskan lagi ininya, apanya? Pertanyaannya.
So there was I think I've lost the chat. So okay, thank you. Gozi from Jakarta. Hello, Gozi. I have a question in biomedical analysis, especially when you work with biomedical data, which is crucial to know if the machine do not do the right thing. Metric evaluation, such as F-score, T-lab, the false positive and false negative rate, they probably have an important meaning in real life. So how do the researcher make sure that the model that was made in machine learning could be deployed in real life with the minimum of error that might lead to the prediction of the best model and worst scenario, such as that? Okay, so what is the best practice? So let me explain what is Gozi is saying, because this is a very important question. Suppose that we have two classes. You remember that we were talking about supervised learning. We said supervised learning means to take the observation and to assign to two specific pre-ordered classes based on a training set of elements for which the class label was known. So now what happens is that the two classes sometimes do not have the same importance. So suppose that I want to predict if a certain patient, for example, a leukemia patient, has a type of two different subtypes of the same leukemia. So leukemia has several subtypes, for example, acute myeloid leukemia lymphoblastic leukemia, and so forth. And those subtypes of the same leukemia need different abundance of chemotherapies. So there some patients only need very little chemotherapy to heal from leukemia. Some others need huge quantities to relief from the disease. Now what happens is that if you say that one that needs a little chemo is in the class of those that need a lot of chemo, these patients will receive a lot of chemotherapy, a lot of drug. So his health will be bad in the sense that he will have several side effects, right? He will survive, but he will have a bad life. If you say that somebody that is in the class of the ones that need a lot of chemo to recover, you say that they belong to the class of those that need little, you give little, and these patients most probably will die. So the misclassification, so assigning the elements to one class or to the other, the error that I commit in assigning to different classes is different, it's not the same. That's why we have to be very careful about how we assign, in case of classification, of supervised classification, to which class we assign the elements. So there is no single way to do this. And F-score is useful in case of unbalanced classes. And this is usually the case, because when we take a situation in which we have control patients, usually in the overall population, the stratification is such that the patients are much less than the healthy people, right? There is no disease that affects more than half of the population. So the two classes are always unbalanced. So accuracy is not enough. Error, classification error is not enough. We need also F-score. Then, depending on what is your aim, what is your task, is you can use sensitivity, specificity, or other parameters to evaluate this condition. So depending on what is your aim, you can choose one parameter that best fits to your aim. I think that this is not in this set of slides, but this is very advanced. This is very advanced topic. Since we were talking about an introduction to machine learning, I decided to not to go so in deep in this type of a question. But if you want, you can contact me on my email. If you search Mario Guarracino, you will find everything, my email or whatever, WhatsApp or whatever, and we can discuss about this. If you have a very specific application on which you want to, I can consult on this.
Okay, I'm sorry, because of the limitation of time, if there are questions that have not been answered, you can contact Professor Mario directly by email at mario.guarracino@cnr.it, right, Professor?
Yes, exactly. And yeah. this is the link. You can take a picture of this, and later you can use this link to download all the material that we have been using in this workshop.
So, ladies and gentlemen, finally we come to the end of the part of our webinar. We would like to say thanks again to audience for your active participation, and thank you for sharing the material, Professor Mario. Hopefully the presentation will be beneficial for us. Thank you for your attention. See you next time, and wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Saya kembalikan ke MC.
Mrs. Ina, and thank you Professor Dr. Mario for sharing with us. It's just a great opportunity and our pleasure to have you with us. We are waiting for more collaboration to come in the future. Again, thank you very much and see you next time.
Bye-bye, thank you.
Before we end up the webinar, would you like to take a picture with us? We will shoot the screen.
Okay.
So, okay, ready.
Can you stop the share screen? Should I share what?
Stop sharing screen, please.
Okay, stop sharing. Like this.
Stop the share screen.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Ready? Let me count. 3, 2, 1, smile. Okay, once again. 3, 2, 1, cheers. Okay, thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, Prof.
Thank you, Prof.
See you next time.
Thank you, Emma. Thank you, everybody. Bye-bye. Take care.
See you next time. Okay. Thank you very
much.
Okay.
Baiklah, kita sudah sampai di penghujung acara pada hari ini. Terima kasih atas segala perhatian Anda. Mohon maaf bila ada kesalahan. Saya Diah Dwi Maharani, mohon undur diri. Terima kasih dan sampai jumpa. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam
warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Ibu,
Bapak, Ibu.
Okay. Jangan lupa untuk partisipasi. Yang belum isi absen.
Sertifikatnya dikirimkan belakangan ya, via email gitu.
Ya, sertifikatnya hari Senin paling lambat.
Hari Senin, iya.
Nanti mohon dicek email Bapak Ibu masing-masing.
Pak Marianya masih di sini kayaknya. Ya enggak apa-apa.
Lupa Bu, Emma tadi saya.